How many of you have ever heard of a default mode or a default setting? If you look up on the web and you do a search for default mode, and I believe our resident science gal back here would possibly know a little bit about this, but a default mode in the scientific realm has to do with the brain. It has to do with connectivity in the brain and how it works and how it functions. There's also another one called default settings, and computer-wise, a default setting is refers to a pre-existing value of a user configurative setting that is assigned to a software application. In other words, it's called a preset or a factory preset. On your iPhone, on your cell phone, on your tablet, on your computer. If you get into some problems, you can go back in the settings, Lord willing, and you can get to that and hit your default mode, and it will revert back to the original way that it was created to do. And the Lord spoke to me about this default mode, and I want to I want to share just a few things with you when we go to this. Remember 2 weeks ago, we talked about Ezra and how the children of Israel had gone into captivity into Babylon. They were in captivity for approximately 70 years. How many remembers that sermon? Sometimes you remember them and sometimes you don't, all right? Israel had been captive for about 7 years. Israel had been taken captive by Babylon, and in the midst of that 70-year captivity, Babylon was overthrown by Persia. Well, God got a hold of the king of Persia, and he sent the children of Israel back. Let me tell you something. Nations just don't release their prisoners just because they're having a good day. God got a hold of that king's heart, and he put a passion in him and a zeal in him, and he sent the children of Israel back. We talked about this just 2 weeks ago. Well, the children of Israel was sent back, and their goal to come back was to rebuild the tabernacle of the Lord, and they were going to rebuild. So as soon as they got back, they began to rebuild the temple of the Lord. Well, how many know anytime that you're doing something for God, there's always going to be setbacks, there's going to be delays, because the enemy comes in and tries to derail you. How many know that? How many have experienced that in your own life? Anytime you take one step towards God, it seems like you get knocked back three. Hello? I'm going to need some cooperation here today. That's all right. All right? So in the midst of that, they rebuilt the floor, the foundation of this tabernacle, and there was great excitement, but opposition arose, and because of that, there was a 17-year delay. They were scared, they delayed, they were like, you know what, I'm not going to do this anymore, and so they started to work on their own houses. They started building up their own life, and the things of God became kind of, thank you, Papu, they became kind of secondary. And so the complete completion of the temple of the Lord actually took 21 years to build because of a delay. And that's what they were set up to do. So now the temple is built, the tabernacle is built, Haggai comes in and says, you know, you're working on this. Nehemiah comes in and rebuilds the walls. All of these books of the Bible are working together. And Ezra, remember 2 weeks ago, Ezra was being sent back. They had letters, they had decrees, they had supplies, they had support. And then all of a sudden, before they get off on the road and everyone was coming back to them, the children of Israel was taken out of captivity and placed back in the... God made a way out of captivity, right? It's kind of a representation of salvation. God sets us free and we go to the place that he wants us to go, right? It's kind of a representation of that. Well, in the midst of that, Ezra decided, you know what, we got to fast. Remember that 2 weeks ago? But after Ezra got back, there was great victory. We will see in Ezra chapter 9 something else taking place which leads us back to default mode. You see, the children of Israel were sent into captivity because of their disobedience to God. They decided to worship other gods. They decided to to live their life how they wanted to live. They would go and burn incense on, and they would serve other gods, and they would do the detestable practices of the people around them. And God told them, hey, listen, don't marry. Sorry, ladies, but you men, don't give your sons to these foreign gals, and don't give, you know, don't give your daughters away to... Why? This was not a racial issue. I want you to understand it. In the nation that we live in, we've got this racial division going on. And can I tell you, it's more than that. Listen, there's a puppeteer, and all of a sudden the puppeteer, and look at this, what's going on. No, there's the devil is behind all this, behind the scenes, and pay no attention to the man behind the curtain over here, right? Well, all the bells and whistles are going on. Listen, the enemy has a plan. It's to steal, kill, and destroy, and literally divide a nation in half, because the word of God says that a nation divided against itself, a house divided against itself, will not stand. And so let me tell you something. If America self-destruction implodes, where's going to be the covering of Israel? Who is going to come to the rescue of Israel? Let me tell you something. We're great allies, and I don't want to get caught off on that, all right? But in Ezra, we see the children of Israel were taken into captivity because of their radical disobedience. This was not an issue of race when they were taking women and sons, but they got carried off. It wasn't an issue of race. God was trying to protect them. I do not want my word to be mixed in and religions mixed together. I don't want that to happen, because it's got to be pure. It's got to be holy. It's got to be righteous. It's got to be done my way. That's what God was saying. And they got carried off into captivity. But here, Ezra comes back home. Everybody with me. Ezra comes back home, and we see this. Ezra chapter 9, verse 1. Read this. After these things had been done, the leaders came to me, and this is Ezra talking, came to me and said, the people of Israel, including the priests and the Levites, have not kept themselves separate from the neighboring peoples with their detestable practices, like those of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Perizzites, the Jezebites, the Ammonites, the Moabites, Egyptian, and Amorites. They have taken some of their daughters as wives from themselves and their sons, and have mingled the holy race with the peoples around them. And the leaders and officials have led the way in this unfaithfulness. And Ezra said this, when I heard this, I tore my tunic and my cloak. Tearing your tunic and your cloak was a sign of humility, a sign of remorse. It was a sign of, oh God, what's going to happen? Right? Oh God, forgive us. It was a sign of repentance. He tore his tunic and his cloak. He pulled hair from his head. Hello, come on, this is crazy stuff. And his beard, and he sat down appalled. Have you ever just sat down and you just can't believe it? You can't even, your mouth is open and flies are flying in your face, right? You're just sitting there and you're like, I have no words. That's what was going on here. And then it says in verse 4, then everyone who trembled at the words of God of Israel gathered around me because of this unfaithfulness of the exiles, and I sat there appalled until the evening sacrifice. What happened? What happened? The children of Israel were sent away into captivity for some 70 years. God heard their cry, brought about deliverance, set them free, wrote his name upon the king of Persia's heart, and the king of Persia sent them back with blessings, and they've reverted to their default mode and starting the same thing all over again. They reverted back to their default mode. The book of Romans tells us this. Romans chapter 6, verse 18, it says, you have been set free from sin and have become slaves to righteousness. Hallelujah. I am using an example from everyday life because of your human limitations. Just as you used to offer yourselves as slaves to impurity and to ever-increasing wickedness, so now offer yourselves as slaves to righteousness leading to holiness. When you were slaves to sin, you were free from the control of righteousness. What benefit did you reap at that time from the things you are now ashamed of? Those things resulted in death. But now that you have been set free from sin and have become slaves to God, the benefit you reap leads to holiness, and the result is eternal life. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. You see, the children of Israel, it had been purged from them. God heard them, but when they came back and God blessed them, they went back to their old ways immediately. And listen, the priests and the ones who were meant to be carriers of God's presence led the way. Let me tell you something. When the spiritual leaders are showing with their lifestyle, for whatever reason, people follow that. Well, pastor's doing it, and it's okay for me. Let me tell you something. We don't abstain from alcohol. We don't abstain from the things of this world just because we want to be more holier than everyone. We abstain from these things because of what God's word says. But if I do those things, then other people are going to do it too. If I have been found in drinking and getting drunk and all these different things, these guys are going to do it. If you do it as a parent, let me tell you something. Exactly what you do, your kids are going to match your spirituality. And if there is a mixture and you're cooking it up, well, they don't know. Let me tell you something. There's a spirit that comes with that, and they will know. You can hide pornography. You can hide all these different things of what you're reading and what you're putting. There's a spirit that comes with that, and it'll attach itself to your children because you've opened the door in your home, and it will come in. If you are found in infidelity and you're hiding it, let me tell you something. Your children are going to do it too. And that's exactly what was happening with the children of Israel. See, no one wants to amen today. You called me wrong. That's what happened. The children of Israel were delivered and set free. But when they came back, they went into default mode. They reverted. So, and here's what's crazy. Some of these children were born in captivity. They didn't even know all these different things. But now all of a sudden they come back, and now some preacher, some televangelist said it's okay. Somebody leads the way. I'm not even making no apologies. Somebody said it was okay to live a lifestyle of homosexuality when it's clearly against God's word. Someone led a way to that. Someone says, well, it's okay to lie a little bit. Sin is sin. Can I tell you? Well, I don't do the big things. Well, you need to stop the small things too. Come on, let's live a life of holiness. What does Romans, we just said it. The benefit, it leads us to holiness, and then from holiness leads to eternal life. Yeah. See, no one wants to talk about these things, these default modes that we go into. We come into church and God sets us free for a moment, but then Monday comes around. Monday comes around, and we're not in the presence of the Holy Spirit like in this room. We're not in the presence of the Holy Spirit, and all of a sudden, we dive right back into the influences that are all around us all the time, and we revert to default mode. We revert to default mode. We revert to worrying and fearing and doubting and gossiping and lying. We revert to these things, even though we know that the Spirit of God just touched us on a Sunday morning and set us free from things and we felt better about it. For whatever reason, we go right back to default mode. Boom. We hit the button. We've lost all our precepts from the Holy Spirit. We've lost. How many have ever lost all your bookmarks from the internet and you're like, oh, that's awful. All of a sudden, we lose all of our bookmarks from the Holy Spirit. We lose all of our bookmarks from our Bible. And it's like we don't even know how to read the Word of God anymore. We revert back to default mode. And now all of a sudden, we find ourselves in a predicament. We find ourselves worshiping God on Sunday, but holding on to fear, worry, and anger, and we hold on to lust and infidelity and lying on Monday, Tuesday, well, maybe not Wednesday because we got church, and then Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, it's all, you know, we're right back to default mode. Listen, God wants to set us free. The Bible says if the Son sets you free, you're free indeed. So why in the world do we try to hold on to the things that have never done us any good? It's never done us. I'm going to sit down. I'm tired. It's never done us any good. Look at the back of that head up there. You better be careful. They're going to think it's you. She's lost all of her hair. Listen, we go to this default mode of our past. Why? Because it's easier. Hey. All right? We get into this default mode because it's easier to do. Patterns are easy to continue in. The things of this world are easy to continue in. You know, if we've got coarse jousting, that would hurt, right? The Bible talks about it, you know, foul language and dirty jokes. It even talks about all these different things. Why? Because it was back then too. Nothing new is under the sun. It's just packaged different. And now we've got these pastors, and I'm sorry, and you'll never hear me call names, but you got these pastors teaching this stuff that, listen, we can't help ourselves, so we're going to go on and now we've extended the perimeters of grace, and now it's okay. I've got family members, because they've sat under that teaching so long, and it sounds so good, Pastor. It sounds good. I've got family members now that they believe that they do not even need to repent anymore because God's grace just covers a multitude, and now I'm good. I've got my get out of hell free card, and I'm good. We revert to default mode. We can't get out of that. And then on top of it, here's what's crazy. And this isn't even my notes. This is all free. All right? And then to top it off, what we do is we see someone who God is really using extravagantly in their life. People are getting saved. People are being transformed. It's just like they're a Holy Spirit magnet wherever they go. You know, God's with them. People are getting healed and people are getting delivered. And just there's just an extravagant attraction to this spirituality. And we want to be like that. But we're not willing to let go of the things of this world that hinder the moving of the Spirit in our life. And so we're stuck in default mode. And then we get mad at God, and we get mad at the church, and we get mad at people because God's using them, and why ain't he using me? Y'all don't want to hear none of this? Listen. So there's effects of this default mode. There's just effects that I want you to understand, and these are just real quick. If you revert to default mode, what it's going to do, it's going to set you back and it will settle you in. If you revert to your default mode, the way you used to, see, God's brought people out of, how many people used to worry really bad? You just worry. How many people are still struggling with that a little bit, you know? Let me tell you something. I was raised in a home that they feared God, but they worried. Worried. And if I'm not careful, I can let myself get really close to hitting that default button. Or maybe I hit it real quick and I try to hit the Apple Control Z to go back so you don't, you know, how many Apple folks do we have here, right? You need to try it. It's good. It's all right. You can deliver yourself from all that other stuff, right? And so here we are. If I'm not careful, I can go right into worrying and fearing and doubting and not know. And God, and I feel that anxiety rise up within my heart and within my spirit. And next thing you know, you're driving yourself to the hospital thinking you have a heart attack. Yeah, I'm right there. I'm right there. Done it. Done it before. done it before. Got halfway to the hospital, and the Holy Spirit said, what are you doing? Lord, I'm having a heart attack. It's, no, you're not. Turn around and go back. You need to give this to me. Hello. Now, really, you need to check your pulse. You need to make sure I'm not, okay? All right, I'm not saying that every, yeah, all right? So the effects of the default mode, if you go into default mode, how you used to live your life, it's going to set you back and it's going to settle you in because it's a place to be comfortable. The second thing it'll do, when you go back to default mode, it removes your covering. What I find is that there's a covering of the Holy Spirit in the parameter of His words. And when I go into default mode and I go back to my old patterns, I get out from underneath that covering. I get out from underneath that covering. You know, you can, and there's many, many things in God's word that you see what happened. Solomon's life, Solomon had a covering of the Holy Spirit and was a man of wisdom, but at the end of his life, because of his love for women, and let's just be really honest, he had a sexual problem. Let's just be real. At the end of his life, the women that he took on as his wife and in his harem, it pulled him away from the things of God. You'll see it. King Saul, there was an anointing on his life. He was the anointed king of Israel. But because of his disobedience and because he went into default mode, I just can't do it. God removed the anointing. He had the crown on his head, but he didn't have the anointing on him. We see different illustrations of this all through Scripture of people who were once under anointing of God, and now because they went into default mode, what is easy? They lost it. So when you go into default mode, it removes your covering. What else does default mode go into? It ignores your future blessings. Because you know that God has a better way, you're going to continue to do. When you go into default mode, you know it, but you ignore God's blessings and God's plan when you go into default mode. If you're here, say, uh-huh. Right? The last one, real quick. The effect of default mode, when you go there, here's what's crazy, and we don't even know, it makes you a prisoner. It makes you a prisoner. And what do? God, I don't understand why I'm in here. How could you let this happen to me? And what happens is we blame God for the position we're in, and we put ourselves there. I went into default mode. I chose to disobey God. I chose to do what I want. I chose to sleep around. I chose to do all this, and now right back to where I am before. And then we get mad at God and the church because of all these different things that's going on. Everybody look at your neighbor and say, All right? So here's what I want to get to. You can tell, I just felt like the Lord kind of brought this around today to show us what happens when we go into this default mode. But I felt like the Holy Spirit spoke to me on a few things. How do you keep from reverting? Some life application. How do you keep from reverting to the default mode, all right? We've already had some people raise their hands. It's worry and it's fear and it's doubt and it's anxiety. And my default mode could be lust. My default mode could be pornography, you know, that are combined. My default mode could be self-satisfaction. My default mode could be gossip. You know what it is, right? I know what it is. But how do you keep from reverting to your default mode? Number one is this. You have to keep the word in front of you. You have to keep the word of God in front of you. Psalm chapter 119, verse 9. And this is what's interesting because people just want God to do this. Oh God, keep me from going back. Let me tell you something. God can keep you from going back, but you need to keep yourself from going back too. Right? You got to keep the word of God in front of you. This is not rocket science. This is just how it works. Psalm 119, verse 9. How can a young person stay on the path of purity? Young people, listen to this. By living according to your word. I seek you with all of my heart. Do not let me stray from your commands. And here it is. This is the money verse, right? We're all in right here. I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. Praise be to you, Lord. Teach me your decrees. With my lips, I will recount all the laws that come from your mouth. I rejoice in following your statutes as one rejoices in great riches. I meditate on your precepts and consider your ways. I delight in your decrees. I will not neglect your word. Ah, can I tell you? Oh, my word. I don't know how many times that I've said it and I've preached it out over 24 years. The word of God has to be predominant in your life. It has to be predominant in your life. It is your soul food. Right? Grits is a soul food. How many grits lovers do I have in the place? Let me tell you something. I like a little grits with my butter. All right? Come on now. Come on. Mix that up in there. Oh, I almost got slain in the spirit right there. Let me tell you something. Listen, it's great. It's good. But the word of God, man, it's soul food. It's the thing that's going to sustain you. It's the thing that's going to keep you from going to your default mode. That's what the word of God does. There's power, there's authority, there's deliverance, and it's all found in your word. Oh God, I don't know what to do. Let me tell you something. Why don't you crack open the word of God instead of cracking open your butt and listen, start focusing on the things of God. See, no one wants to hear that this morning. I got to cheer myself on because no one listening. Listen, you got to keep the word of God in front of you. You have to. I have to. Well, you're the preacher. You got to do that every day. Come on, every single day. You dig in. You dig in. Maybe it's 5 minutes. Maybe it's a couple hours, but you dig in. You let the word of God. Well, Pastor, I don't like to read. Let me tell you something. You got a little app. It's called the YouVersion Bible right on your phone. It'll read it to you. How much more simple can it be? Let the word of God pour into you. Oh, instead of sitting there just vegging all the time on Netflix. And can I tell you, if you got Apple TV, it'll read it to you right over your TV, whatever version you want it. Let the word of God be predominant in your house. You don't want to go back to the way things were in your life. Keep the word of God in front of you. The word of God in Hebrews says the word of God is alive and powerful. It's sharper than the sharpest two-edged sword, cutting between the soul and the spirit, between joint and marrow. You got to keep the word of God in front of you. The second thing, how do you keep from reverting to your default mode? No one gonna like this. But you have to on purpose. Everybody say on purpose. You have to, on purpose, surround yourself with godly influences. And we think that godly influences are just people that you hang out with. Let me tell you something. You can have godly influences, ungodly influences, and it not have anything to do with the person sitting right next to you. It's what you're putting into your heart and putting into your ears and putting into your mind and putting into your spirit. Let me tell you something. If the enemy can get you to laugh at something, he's got you. He's got you. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 22. Let us draw near to God with a sincere, everybody say sincere. Right? Let us draw near to God with a sincere heart. And with full assurance that faith brings, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience, and having our bodies washed with pure water. Listen to this. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. And here's another money verse right here. And let us consider how we may spur one another on towards love and good deeds. Let's not giving up, give up on meeting together as some are in the habit of doing, but encourage one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. You got to surround yourself with godly influences. And can I suggest to you, some of us were struggling and we're reverting to our old ways because of old acquaintances. Some of you are flirting on Facebook with old flames that don't need to be rekindled. And that's not in the notes, so you can write it down. That's coming from the Holy Spirit. Some of us are getting all stirred up when you're married over here and you got this over here. You need to cut that thing off. Because destruction is around the corner. You know, in the beginning, Adam and Eve, garden, right? Sin, kicked out. Children, Cain and Abel. And God went to who? Cain? And he was mad. He was mad, remember? And God spoke to him and he said, you better watch out because sin is crouching at your door. God warned him before he killed his brother. God gave him a way out. It's crouching at your door. Let me tell you something. If we're not careful, right through Facebook, right through social media, right through all this, we're getting stuck. And, oh, Pastor, you don't know. Let me tell you something. I do know. I got family members right now that are reverting and meeting up with their old husbands. Because the grass was greener on the other side how it used to be, and so I'm going to abandon what I got now because I got over here. See, nobody likes to hear stuff like that. Sometimes I get so frustrated because the way we preach, it's like we can't grow because this. But I'm going to tell you something, we're going to preach the Word of God. We're just going to preach the Word of God. And Lord, let it be. Let it be. This word spur, and I need to cruise on here. It's a Greek word that we're used for spur, and it's the Greek word 3948, paroxysmos. Say that really quick. Paroxysmos. In this word spur, it means contention. Now, when we think of spur, we think of clink, 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 and right. And you know, you kick the horses, right? We get the spurs back behind us, clinging, clinging. There ain't not enough room in this town for both of us, right? You think of that, those kind of spurs that's behind our boots, right? This word means contention. When it says, and let us consider how we may spur one another, let us consider how we will push to contention one another. It means to provoke. Let us consider how we may provoke one another. Now, you got to read on, right? Provoke one another towards love and good deeds, right? It's not like being annoying. It's like, I'm not touching you, right? Is this bothering you at all? Is this bothering you? Okay. It's not talking about provoking and it's that kind of provoke, but let's push one another on. It means to incite. It means to sharpen. Let's see how we can sharpen one another. And this one's a crazy one. It actually means an irritation. Here's what's funny. You try to go get somebody that's on the fringe and it's out, and they get mad at you. They get irritated. They get irritated because you see the impending doom that's coming around the corner, and they don't see it. How many know what I'm talking about? They don't see it, but you try to go after them. Let's spur one another on, and all of a sudden it's an irritation. Instead of it being a burr in your saddle, it's a spur in your saddle, right? It's an irritation, and you're getting on my nerves, and why don't you just leave me alone? I got to do me and all these different things. Listen, the Bible says in Proverbs that iron sharpens iron, so a friend sharpens a friend. If you want to keep reverting to your default mode, you have got to surround yourself with godly influences. Number three, How do you keep reverting into the default mode? You've got to learn how to run from and into. You got to learn to run from and into. Titus chapter 2, verse 11 through 13, it says this, "For the grace God has appeared, for the grace of God has appeared that offers salvation to all people." And here it is. Remember we just said say grace. It teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age while we wait for the blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ. That grace is completely different than the vast majority of grace teachings that's going on today. They're using it as a cover up instead of something that is to be used to say no to ungodliness and righteousness. It's by the grace of God I can say yes to the things of God. It's by the grace of God that I can say yes to His word. It's by the grace of God that I can do this. It teaches me. The grace of God teaches me to say no, not yes. It teaches me to say no to the things of the world instead of declaring, well, I'm helpless. I can't do it on my own. And so I'm going to continue on to live in this lifestyle that I'm living. And I just know that I'm covered by the blood of Jesus and I can go on doing what I'm doing. Here's what I do know. The grace of God and the blood of God covers a multitude of sins. But here's the kicker. I don't know where the grace of God begins, and I don't know where it ends. So I'm gonna play it really close to the deck here. I'm staying as close that I can to my Lord and Savior and as close as I can to the Word of God. Do I mess up? Yes, I do. Do I slip up? Yes, I do. Do I say things I shouldn't say? Yes, I do. But I know this, that I am covered by the blood of Jesus. And this is where repentance come in. Repentance is not a, oh Lord, I'm sorry. Please bless this mess. Repentance is a turning away from those things, away from and into. When we repent, we turn away from the things that are causing hindrance in my life, sin that so easily besets us, and turning in and running into the arms of my Savior, Lord Jesus Christ. Turning away, because He can help us overcome sin. The Holy Spirit will help us to say no to sin and unrighteousness. He will help us do that. He will help us to overcome and get through those things. But many times we go into this default mode and we say, well, that's just the way it is. Can't help myself. Can't help myself, Pastor. My great-grandmother was a worrier. My grandma was a worrier. My mom was a worrier. My dad was a worrier. And they didn't, they called it nerve pills back in the day. I just got to take a nerve pill. They were drug addicts and they didn't even know it. And a woman ran out, hey, you got any of that stuff over there? Come on, what is that? You know what that is. Y'all want to hear it. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, it says this, "Rejoice always. Pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Do not quench the Spirit. Do not treat prophecies with contempt, but test them all. Hold on to what is good and reject." Everybody say reject. And reject every kind of evil. Reject it. You got to learn, if you're going to stay away from your default mode, you've got to reject the things of the flesh. You're going to have to reject it because it's going to become calling to you. Like, how many of you ever studied Greek mythology? Okay, you may not study it, but you had an awful lot of videos from the 1980s with the clay animation, right? Jason and the Argonauts, and they're driving in the boats, and he wanted to hear the sirens calling, but if you heard them, you sail your ship over there, and you would crash to your death. Well, he wanted to hear that. Can I tell you, those things right there, you've got to plug those ears up. You've got to plug those eyes up, and you've got to focus on the Word of God and ask. He's the one that's going to empower you. Things won't change just because you wish them to change. You never, nobody ever in the history of ever got the devil to leave them alone by just talking them down. Oh, devil, will you just, can you just cut me some slack? Let me tell you, no one in the history of ever has that ever happened. You take authority over him in the name of Jesus, and you begin to confess, I'm a child of God. I don't have the right or the authority to go back to these things because I'm covered by the blood of Jesus. Want to keep reverting from your default mode? You got to learn how to run from and into. And lastly is this. How to keep from reverting to your default mode. Number four is simply this. You got to change your mind. You got to change your mind. You got to change your stinking thinking, the way you used to think. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, it says this, for though we live in the world, we do not wage war as the world does. For the weapons we fight with are not the weapons of the world. On the contrary, the weapons that we fight with have divine power to demolish strongholds. We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God and take captivity, every thought to make it obedient to Christ. You got to change the way you think. Instead of saying, well, I can't do it, I can't make it, how about quoting the Word of God that's hidden in your heart, Roy, and saying, you know what, I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. I can do it. I know with God's help, I'm going to be able to make it. With God's help, I'm going to get through this time of addiction that's drawn me in. With God's help, I'm not going to be lying or gossiping anymore. With God's help, I'm going to be able to do it. We've got to change the way we think. But if we're constantly going in and say, well, you know what, you can't teach an old dog new tricks. That's baloney. You give me an old dog, you give him enough treats, he's going to do whatever you want to. Right? Isn't that the truth? How about we treat ourselves to God's word and see that his blessings are righteous, his blessings are holy, his blessings are for his people, and see. Man, I'll tell you what, once you start seeing that if you do things God's way and you'll see the blessings of God come upon your life, I will tell you this, you'll learn a new trick real quick. Hello? You got to change your mind. Well, Pastor, you don't understand. You know, there's just this battle in my mind. There's just this war in my spirit that it just keeps on me over and over and over again. Let me tell you something. The Word of God has the antidote for everything that you're going through ever. Romans chapter 12. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing unto God. This is your true and proper worship. Worship is not just happening on Sunday mornings when pastor says, you know, put your hands up in the air, let's praise God for a second. That is a form of worship, but true worship is offering your bodies as living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. It says this in verse 2, and I close with this. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Renewing of your mind. Let me tell you, if you can't, I'll tell you what, many times we just talk ourselves down out of it. Because it's easier to slip into the patterns of the way we did things. So listen. So here was Ezra. Ezra fasted. He got his peeps back, right? Back in. They went in. The tabernacle was finished. The walls are up. Everyone's excited. But all of a sudden, the priests and the leaders are leading the way in this default mode. They're leading the way. Ezra got mad, stomped his feet. Feeling my hands, feeling my feet, right? He got mad, tore his robes, pulled out his hair. See, now you know what happened, guys. Well, just teasing. Pulled out his hair, pulled out his beard, sat down, stunned in amazement. And he sat there to the evening sacrifice. But something happened. I love it when something happens. Something happened in Ezra chapter 10. It says, while Ezra was praying and confessing, weeping and throwing himself down before the house of God, all of a sudden, a large number of Israelites, men and women and children, gathered around him, and they too wept bitterly. All of a sudden, the Spirit of God came over them. All of a sudden, the anointing came over them. Suddenly, something shifted in an atmosphere that was stale, in an atmosphere that was going back to their default mode, in an atmosphere where there was no hope and they were in risk of going back into captivity. All of a sudden, something happened. And it took a man of God. It took someone to stand for righteousness and holiness and to stand up and speak what is true and to speak what is righteous and sitting there and crying out before God. Let me tell you something. You don't think you can change the world? Ezra changed the world around him because he walked in holiness. He walked in humility. He walked in repentance. And now all of a sudden it wasn't just him sitting there. Now a great multitude of men and women and children were now they were weeping bitterly too because they could see the impending doom. They wanted out of the default mode. They didn't want to go there anymore. And then Shenachiah, one of the descendants of Elam, said to Ezra, we have been unfaithful. See, here's where confession. You can feel bad about something and never confess it. It's very important that we confess our sins to the Lord. We tell him about it. He said, we've been unfaithful to our God by marrying foreign women. Remember, this was not a racial issue. God was trying to, instead of corrupting his word, he didn't want all these other influences in there. This wasn't a racial issue. This was a spiritual issue. But now, in spite of this, there is hope for Israel. Now let us make a covenant before our God to send away all these women and their children in accordance to the counsel of my Lord and those who fear the commandments of our God. Let it be done according to the law. Rise up. This matter is in your hands and we will support you. So take courage and do it. And the Bible says in verse 5, they all took the oath. Let me tell you something. That's hard to do. I want you to hear this really quick. They went outside of God's plan and purpose. This God is not condoning divorce here. God's not condoning that he was trying to keep the children of Israel from reverting to their old ways. So now they got to let go to their own patterns. There was men and women, they loved their children. They loved, but they had to push that off to the side. God's not condoning divorce here, but what he is saying, I don't want you to go back. I don't want you to go back to this. And they made a covenant and God spared them from that day. Y'all hear me today? God doesn't want you to live your life in default mode. God sent his son Jesus Christ to die so that we could be brought out of that default mode. Any of you who knows anything about computers and apps and all this stuff, you can have extensions that, not in your hair, okay, but you can have extensions put on the programs and you can add stuff that's better to your programs and all those different things. You can add stuff to it. On our website, there's extensions and we can add things to it to make it better and to make it easily accessible. We can add these things to it, but if we were to revert back to our default mode, we would lose all those things. We would lose all those blessings. Hello? We would lose all those presets. And what happens is when we refuse to move on and stay in our default mode, we're literally refusing God of blessings in our life. We're refusing that. And we're saying, my way's better. It's easier this way. Sure, it's easier. Because the Bible says broad is the path to destruction. Right. It's easy to go into destruction. Broad is the path to destruction. And God's saying, listen, if you do it my way, it's going to be so much easier. It's going to be so much easier if you do it my way. And blessings will be upon your life that you never even knew possible. Every head bowed and every eye closed, let me ask you this question. Is there anyone here with the sound of my voice that you would say before the Lord, you would say this, Pastor, I need to give my life to Jesus Christ. I've been doing things my own way and I need to make it right before him. If that's you here this morning, you want to give your life to him, maybe it's the first time or maybe you just want to just a fresh start today. If that's you, just slip your hand up in the air and say, you know what, preacher, that's me. I want you to pray with me. God bless you. God bless you. Anyone, God, one, two, three. Anybody else? Just say, you know what, thank you. God bless you. God bless you. Anybody else who's going to join these four? You can put your hand down if you already raised it. Can we pray this prayer together? Father, help me. I need you. Without your help, I'm not going to make it. So I confess with my mouth that Jesus is Lord. And I believe in my heart that God raised him from the dead. I love you, Jesus. Will you help me? I know you will. Come into my heart. Forgive me of all my sins. And help me to live for you. In Jesus' name.